The first challenge the Holy Spirit gives us is that your palace has a purpose. It means you were not saved by good works, but you were saved for good works. Holy Spirit is challenging us that the reason why God, one of the reasons why God saves you is not just so that you will have a better life on earth, but so you will reach out to others. Holy Spirit challenges us that your influence, you're an amazing singer, you're an amazing wrestler, you're an amazing runner, you're an amazing swimmer, you're an amazing communicator. People know you in the community because you're an amazing businessman, and the Holy Spirit is saying, I want you to leverage your influence for your purpose. I don't want you to see your fame, your finances. I don't want you to see your success and your physical appearance as an end to itself. Esther, you're beautiful. But that's not the point. Use your beauty as a leverage to touch other people's lives. And that's what Holy Spirit will challenge you. He's not going to challenge you to resign and says, hey King, I quit. I'm going to go and suffer with my people. He's going to say, use what you have for the leverage of my kingdom. But the second thing the Holy Spirit will challenge us with is to pay a price to reach that purpose. I think one of the reasons why we do very little about reaching out to people. Everyone loves the idea of winning souls as long as it doesn't cost me anything. As long as I don't have to come out of my comfort zone, and as long as everybody will like me and accept me. And if somebody might not like me, my popularity and my acceptance is more important than them. What would happen if Jesus would say, I would love to save the humans as long as they would treat me right. But if it's gonna smell like these guys are not gonna like me, forget about it. Them, their earth and everything. We can burn their galaxy and make a lot of new ones. Jesus never had that. He knew that there's gonna be a cost in bringing salvation to me. There might be a cost of you reaching out your faith for other people. Can somebody say amen? I remember a story that really touched me. And it's a story of an Armenian champion swimmer, Shavarsh Karapetyan. And if he is watching or listening, I'm sorry if I mispronounced your name. He's a retired Soviet Armenian champion swimmer. He's an 11-time world record holder, 17-time world champion, and a 13-time European champion, and 7-time USSR champion. On September 16, 1976, him and his brother were running. His brother Kamo. They were running together for 12 miles. It was their typical workout exercise time. And as they were running, it was very cold outside, and they saw in front of them a bus that had 92 people slid off of a bridge and fell into a water. And it was about 70 feet away from them, so it was not too close. It was extremely cold. And this swimmer, he was really good at swimming, and he was really good at swimming, and he had records and championships. And here he has a chance to jump into a dirty cold water or to keep running. He stops, jumps into a water. He goes about 33 feet deep into a dark, because it was already dark, water, freezing polluted water. With his hands and with his feet, he breaks the window of the glass and one by one begins to pull people out. He made about 30 something dives in there. It took him from 4 to 5 seconds for each person. He brought up more than 20 people on the surface, but only 20 people survived. At the end, when they asked him, what do you think about what just happened? This is what he said. This is him. He said, I knew that I could only save so many lives. I was afraid to make a mistake. It was so dark down there that I could barely see anything. One of my dives, I accidentally grabbed a seat instead of a passenger. I could have saved a life instead. And that seat still haunts me in my nightmares. Because of this feat, he became unconscious for 46 days. He lost his ability to compete because his lungs got so polluted with cold and also freezing water. He was never able to compete again. Because this happened during a time of Soviet Union, this story actually wasn't published until 2 years after this incident. On a big newspaper in former Soviet Union, they posted the story. And people started to literally call him a hero. Because of one newspaper, he received 60,000 letters of people saying thank you for leveraging your championship for souls. But it didn't end there for this man. He was addicted to these things. In 1985, he was also walking by a building that was on fire and there were people trapped inside. And not being experienced because he wasn't a firefighter, he got into the building and he saved people, almost lost his life, and ended up next few months being in the hospital again. And this man was addicted not to fame, championship, or titles, but changing people's lives. Nobody knows about him being a champion today. Almost everybody knows him as a man who is a hero. Because you have to know one more thing the Holy Spirit teaches us. A reward is always greater than the risk. You see, when people get saved, the joy that comes from that is unparalleled. I know that about myself when in 2005, January 27th, right here in the service, the pews were still blue. Two, three pews of just our cousins, and we were praying for already 5 years for people to be saved. And we didn't see people being saved. It was one young man who came to the service and I preached a message called Exchange, from guilt to justification. And I preached it hot. And at the end, I gave first time an altar call because there was one new person there. And I was doing an altar call as though there was 20 new people. And that poor guy was looking at me. And I was trying to do an altar call, so pumping everybody up. I asked everybody to bow their eyes and close his eyes, and he didn't. And I asked people who want to give their life to Jesus to lift their hands. And before I'm looking at him, he looks at me. And we have our own little communication, and I see he starts to cry. My heart begins to bubble inside. Because not only we have a new person, but he's crying. And he lifts his hands and gives his life to Jesus. I remember when I led him in a sinner's prayer, and when that ended, I hugged every person I met that night. I've experienced an amount of joy. I've never done drugs, but I can tell you one thing. The ecstasy, the joy that you receive seeing a person give their life to Jesus pales in comparison with anything. I can only understand it the day when Jesus, when disciples brought him sandwiches, he says, guys, I already have food. He says, I just talked to a woman and she gave her life to God and that is my food. And disciples like, what are you talking about? And I think Peter knew what Jesus was talking about on the day of Pentecost when thousands of people got saved. I think Peter at that day remembered, oh, that's what Jesus was talking about. This is so much better than anything else. You see that, I see that in other people. When I remember when my friend Eder, when he invited somebody and that person gave his life to Jesus, and on that day Eder only slept 2 hours. He's like, I was thinking about not coming to church, and he was bawling his eyes out in this service. Not because he got $1 million, not because he, you know, got a big gift or a car, but just because of one thing. Somebody's soul got saved. You may say, why is that so important? Because their eternity is going to change. And the Holy Spirit gives you a dose of that joy to get you addicted seeing people's lives changed. I would rather be addicted to seeing people's lives changed than being addicted to see my own life being ruined. A lot of people are addicted to things that will ruin their life. Let's be addicted to things that will change people's eternity. Let's be addicted to things that will change our city and change our generation. Remember, even when our leaders would testify and share their faith with somebody and we have a group text message, and then they will send a text message saying, we just shared our faith with this and that person. And you see that joy, you see that excitement. That's why when our church begins to see more people giving their lives to Jesus, there's one thing that's going to increase in our church: joy. Joy doesn't come when we drive nice cars. Joy doesn't come when we build mansions. You know people who have mansions and fall and throw themselves from a 19-story building and destroy themselves. Why? Because joy comes, the Bible says, when we see people come to Jesus Christ. Heaven throws a party, not when you get a breakthrough, but when you win a soul. leverage your palace. Leverage your gifts. Leverage your influence. Your life is very short. You don't want to be known as a person who has a world record. You want to be known as a person who leverages it to change a person's eternity.